Greetings, this is Father Michael with our word of the week. This week's word is wait. Wait. In our gospel today, we hear Jesus' most dramatic miracle, the raising of Lazarus, as we continue in this cycle A for those who are preparing to come into the church through our RCIA process. And there's a detail that frames this story, which gives us insight into our own spiritual life and the power of waiting on the Lord. The story begins with those good friends of Jesus, Martha and Mary, and Lazarus, and in fact, Martha and Mary indeed sending notice to Jesus that Lazarus is ill. In fact, he's so ill, he's ill unto death. And it says in the gospel something very interesting. It says, now Jesus loved Martha and Mary and Lazarus, and so he waited for 2 days before he began to travel. And it takes him 2 days to get there, so it's 4 days after word is sent to Jesus, come quickly, that he actually arrives. And if you're wondering, why did Jesus wait when he loved Martha and Mary and Lazarus? Why did he wait when he heard Lazarus was so ill and was needing a companionship, if nothing else? And if you're asking yourself that, you're not alone. Every person in this gospel who has a speaking voice and who we hear in direct quotation asked Jesus the very same thing. The disciples say to Jesus, why are we waiting? Why aren't we going right away? Again, the crowd says when Jesus finally arrives, oh, finally, here he is. I'm paraphrasing here. He's the one who healed all these people, and yet he couldn't heal the one he loved. And then one after the other, both Martha and Mary begin their discussion or their conversation with Jesus by saying, Lord, if you had just gotten here more quickly, our brother would not have died. Again and again, Jesus is asked about this kind of baffling behavior. Why did he wait? Jesus makes it clear that there's a power to his waiting. In this particular instance, he knows that he's going to raise Lazarus from the dead. And so according to Jewish custom, it needs 4 days before someone is officially declared dead. When the signs of corruption and stench and all the rest are evident, no one could ever say, well, Jesus just kind of resuscitated or brought someone out of a coma. And so he says very clearly, I'm waiting so that the glory of God might be revealed, that you might know that I am the resurrection and the life. Only when it can be proved beyond a shadow of a doubt that what Jesus is going to do is a literal resuscitation, bringing someone back from the dead, does Jesus act. And of course, those in that moment could not have known that was Jesus' plan, but it offers insight to our own spiritual life. How many times in our own lives do we pray very, very earnestly for a particular intention or blessing or for God's healing hand in our lives, and it seems like God is not answering? It seems like God's response is delayed, and we think, Lord, what are you waiting for? I need help, and I need it now. And yet, the Lord is once again reminding us in this gospel that there is no hurt or wound or evil that could befall us that cannot be part of his loving plan for us in the future. In other words, for those who wait, the Lord can transform any aspect of our lives, which is loss or hurt or death, into the newness of his own life. And how comforting that knowledge is, how powerful that revelation is in our lives. And so this Lenten season, as we approach the power and the glory of the resurrection, as we in ourselves ask the Lord to transform my heart and my life, we do well to consider, how is it that we wait on the Lord? Last week I talked about that sense of clarity, that there's only clarity in our lives when we are able to trust in the Lord. So too, there can only be new life in our hearts, that new life of the Spirit in Christ's resurrection, when we are willing to wait on the Lord's time. And so blessed are those who wait, for they shall see the salvation of God. Amen.